العلم أشراف مطلب وطالبه لله أكرام من يمشي على قدم. العلم نور مبين يستضيء به أهل السعادات والجهال في الظلم.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على محمد رسول الله، سيد الأولين والآخرين وإمام الأنبياء والمرسلين والشافع المشفع يوم الدين، وعلى آله الطيبين وأزواجه الطاهرات أمهات المؤمنين وصحابته الغر الميامين ومن استنى بسنته واهتدى بهديه ليوم الدين. أما بعد، حياكم الله أيها الإخوة والأخوات إلى هذا اللقاء من لقاءات نداءات القرآن. My dear brothers and sisters, you're welcome to this new session of the sessions of the calls of the Quran. النداء اليوم هو النداء الثالث في سياقات نداءات القرآن، وهو نداء الله عز وجل لآدم عليه السلام. النداء الثالث من نداءات القرآن، وهو نداء الله عز وجل لآدم عليه السلام، أو النداء الثالث من نداءات آدم. النداء الأول كان في الآية 21 من سورة البقرة في نداء الله عز وجل للناس. So we were in the first call, it was in ayah 21 of Surah Al-Baqarah, the call of Allah to all mankind. ثم تكلمنا على النداء الأول من نداءات الله لآدم، وهي خمسة مواضع. وهي خمسة مواضع. And then we spoke about the calls of Allah to Adam, and they are in five places in the Quran. في سورة البقرة في الآية 33، in سورة البقرة آية 33، وفي سورة البقرة الآية 35، وفي سورة الأعراف، وفي سورة الأعراف في الآية 19، وفي سورة طه في الآية 117، وفي سورة طه الآية 120. So Allah Ta'ala has directed five calls to Adam. Ya Adam, O Adam. Five calls in the whole Quran. The first is in Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 33. And the second as well in Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 35. And the third is in Surah Al-A'raf, in Ayah 19. And the fourth is in Surah Taha, in the ayah 117, and the fifth and last is in Surah Taha, ayah 120. اليوم نتكلم على النداء الثاني من نداءات الله عز وجل لآدم. So today we're going to talk about the second call of the calls of Allah to Adam في القرآن, as in the Quran. قال الله عز وجل وقلنا يا آدم, إذن هو النداء الثاني لآدم وهو الثالث في القرآن. So it is the second call to Adam, but it is the third call of the calls of the Quran. قال تعالى وقلنا يا آدم اسكن أنت وزوجك الجنة. قلنا يا آدم, النداء الأول, قال يا آدم أنبئهم بأسمائهم. The first call was, O Adam, inform them, O Adam, inform them of the names of these creations that Allah Ta'ala offered to the angels to show them that he knows more than he knows more than them, and he knows what is in their minds and hearts and what they expose. النداء الثاني, the second call كان أمر من الله عز وجل للنبي السلم أن لآدم عليه السلام أن يسكن الجنة. The second call from Allah the Almighty is to Adam to settle in the Jannah. قال تعالى وقلنا يا آدم اسكن أنت وزوجك الجنة. We said, O Adam, reside you and your wife in the Jannah. Reside and dwell. Reside you and your wife in the paradise, in the Jannah. وكلا منها رغدا حيث شئتما. And eat therefrom in ease and abundance from wherever you wish. ولا تقرب هذه الشجرة. But do not approach this tree. ولا تقرب هذه الشجرة فتكون من الظالمين. فتكون من الظالمين. Lest you be among the wrongdoers. Among the wrongdoers. فأزلهما الشيطان عنها. فأزلهما الشيطان عنها فأخرجهما مما كان فيه. But the Satan caused him to slip out of the of it, meaning of the نعم سنأتي على we'll explain that. And نعم فأزلهما الشيطان عنها فأخرجهما مما كان فيه. And removed them from that condition in which they had been. وقلنا اهبطوا منها جميعا بعضكم لبعض عدو ولكم في الأرض مستقر ومتاع إلى حين. And we said go down, all of you, Adam, Eve, and Satan, as enemies to one another, Yani, Adam and Eve, enemies to the Shaitan, and the Shaitan is enemy to Adam and Eve. And you will have upon the earth a place of settlement and provision for a time, for a determined time. لما خلق الله عز وجل آدم وفضله أتم نعمته عليه. أتم نعمته عليه. When Allah تعالى created Adam and he honored him more than إبليس more than the Satan. نعم أتم نعمته عليه. أتم نعمته عليه. He Allah تعالى perfected his blessing upon him, upon Adam. وذلك بأن خلق له منه من بدنه زوجه ليسكن إليها. And that by creating from him, from his body, his spouse to settle to. وأمرهما أن يسكن الجنة. And he, Allah Ta'ala, commanded them both to reside in the Jannah. وأن يأكلا من أي ثمارها شاء. And that they eat from whatever fruits of the Jannah they wish. كما قال ربنا عز وجل في آية أخرى إن لك ألا تجوع فيها ولا تعرى وأنك لا تضمأ فيها ولا تضحى. الله تعالى said in other ayah that you will never feel hunger and never be seen naked and that never that you never be thirsty, and know that you be yani having heat of climate or hot climate. لكن الله عز وجل منعهما من الأكل من شجرة معينة لم يذكر اسمها، وليس مهما ذكر اسمها لأن ما حرمت لعينها، وإنما التحريم كان ابتلاء واختبارا. عندنا الله تعالى assigned a specific tree and told Adam and Eve, do not eat, do not come close to this tree. The forbidding of eating or coming close to this tree is not for anything of that tree, but it's a kind of trial, a test. Kind of trial and a test. But Allah Azza wa Jal nahahuma an ya'kula min hadhihi ash-shajara. So Allah Ta'ala forbid for them to eat from that specific tree. Naam. Wa وَقَالَ فَتَكُونَ مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ، يعني النتيجة لو أكلتم تكون من الظالمين. كيف يكون ظالمين؟ ظلم أنفسهما بمعصية أمر الله، بمعصية أمر الله. And here Allah Ta'ala said to them both, and do not come close to that tree, do not eat from that tree, so that you do not become wrongdoers or oppressors. How come they are wrongdoers or oppressors? Wrongdoers because they did not stick to the command of Allah, did not stay away from what Allah forbid for them. And by that, they oppress themselves. لأنه كل من ارتكب معصية فقد ظلم نفسه. فقد ظلم نفسه لأنه جعلها عرضة لعقاب الله. عرضة لعقاب الله. As anybody commit a sin, then he has oppressed himself, no doubt. Why? Because he put himself forth to the punishment of Allah. He put himself in the deserve, and he made himself deserving the punishment of Allah. وَهَذَا ظُلْمٌ لَهَا. And that is an oppressing to your soul. وَلَذَا قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فَتَكُونَا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ. And that's why Allah Ta'ala said to Adam and Eve, and you become wrongdoers or oppressors. وَالْآنْ أُنظُرْ مَعْنِي يَا أَخِي. شَجَرَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ هَلْ تَكُونَ شَجَرَ خَبِيثَةً؟ لَا يُمْكِن. الجنة ليس فيها إلا الطيب. And look now with me, my brother and my sister. A tree in the Jannah. Why Allah forbid it? Is it because it's a bad tree? It's a something that yani not good for you to eat? No. All what is in the Jannah is good. لكن نوع الابتلاء والاختبار. But it is only the test and trial. والواجب على المسلم أن يمتثل أمر الله وينزجر عما نهى عنه. And what is obligatory upon the Muslim is to stick to the command of Allah and stay away from the things that Allah forbid. حتى ينجو, so that you يعني be survived. نعم. وإلا العقاب ليس يسيرا. مهما قل العقاب فإنه ليس يسير. ليس يسير. ما ليس عقاب مما أراده الله وقدره ليس يسير. مثل ضمة القبر. مثل ضمة القبر. That which is not a kind of يعني punishment is not easy. Like the squeeze of the grave. والتي كل الناس سيمر بها حتى المؤمن. Which all يعني mankind will go through, even the believers. العرض والحساب كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لعائشة, من نوقش الحساب عذب. The reckoning and questioning and judgment on the day of judgment, on the day of resurrection, that itself is a kind of torment. As the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Aisha, he whoever يعني questioned or reckoning, then that's a kind of يعني تورمنت. ولذلك ينبغي الإنسان أن يحذر، وإذا ما وقع أن يبادر بالتوبة والاستغفار. And that's why the Muslim need to be careful, and whenever he fall into a sin, he need to quickly repent and seek for forgiveness. هذا قال ولا تقرب هذه الشجرة فتكون من الظالمين. فأزلهم الشيطان عنها، فأزلهم الشيطان عنها، أي حملهما على الزلل، أي حملهما على الزلل. But the shaitan caused them to slip out of it. How? He يعني deceived them. He advised them in a way of deception. نعم. كما قال الله عز وجل وقاسمهما إني لكما لمن الناصحين فدلهما بغرور. قاسمهما يعني أقسم. Allah Ta'ala in the other ayah said that the Satan swore by Allah to Adam and Eve that he is only an advisor for them. See? إذن قال نعم إني لكم لمن الناصحين فدلهما بغرور فاغتر. They believed him. They believed him. أين الخطأ هنا؟ الخطأ أن الله حذرهما، قال إن الشيطان لكم عدو، قال فلا يخرجنك، فلا يخرجنكم الشيطان منها. So Allah Ta'ala warned Adam and Hawa. وهكذا نحن حذرنا ونصحنا وأمرنا ونهينا. Alike wise, we the Muslims today, we are warned against يعني the sin and against the shaitan, and we are commanded to do the good, and for things forbidden for us, and we are told to stay away from them. فإذا امتثلنا جاءنا من الله الهدى والتوفيق والسداد، وإذا أخلفنا تركنا الله عز وجل لاختيارنا ولأهوائنا ولعدونا. As if we obey Allah Ta'ala and stick to His commands and return whenever we يعني commit in a sin and seek for forgiveness and repent, then Allah will increase us in guidance and success and firmness upon the truth. But if we continue to يعني commit more sins and more sins and abandon more obligations, then Allah Ta'ala will leave us for what we choosing, will leave us for our desires, will leave us for our enemy, Shaitan. فعلينا أن ننتبه. So we have to be careful. والله تعالى أعلم، وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.
جزاك الله خير شيخنا، الله يبارك فيك. نبدأ بالأسئلة إن شاء الله.
تفضل.
طيب، so I'm gonna unlock the question, the chat room, بإذن الله الكريم. So just before I do that, inshallah ta'ala, as we mentioned last week at the beginning of this series on Q&A with the Sheikh, that we abide by some rules, inshallah ta'ala, which are general etiquettes. That being, number one, beneficial. Your questions have to be beneficial to you and the listeners. Number two, not controversial. And number three, not lengthy, not taweel, and to the point, inshallah ta'ala. So with that, inshallah, I'll open the chat. So you guys can now you guys can now message. Barakallahu feekum. طيب شيخ، السؤال جاء من يوتيوب.
نعم.
So we got a question here from YouTube. شيخ، is it permissible for non-Muslims to do their own type of prayer in our masajid if there is a greater interest of them learning Islam in our places of worship? Any authentic evidence? And is there any authentic evidence for that?
First of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said as in Surah Al-Jinn, وأن المساجد لله فلا تدعو مع الله أحدا. And indeed the masajid belongs to Allah, so invoke no one with Allah, meaning in them or in general. Their worships are based on calling other than Allah. So how come we allow them to perform their worships in our masajid if they are calling other than Allah? If they are interesting, if they are interested in learning about Islam, they can join us. They can come to the Jum'ah and attend, or they come to a lecture or talk, no problem. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اِسْتَجَارَكَ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أَبْلِغُهُ مَأْمَنَهُ ثُمَّ أَبْلِغُهُ مَأْمَنَهُ. So Allah ta'ala commanded the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that whenever any of the mushrikeen seek a shelter with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam provided for him, that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should provide it for him, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. And if any of the mushrikeen, the polytheists, seeks your protection, then grant him protection so that he may hear the words of Allah, the Quran, meaning the Quran. Then deliver him to his place or destination, place of safety. That is because they are a people who do not know. So if they want to learn, if they want to know about Islam, they are welcome to our masajid, but not to conduct their worships, or because their worships are based on shirk, on calling other than Allah. So that is not allowed in the masajid of Allah. Wallahu a'lam.
Ahsan Allahu ilaykum, Shaykh. A question here is asking on Zoom, can I do itikaf at home since the masajid might be shut this Ramadan? Can I have it? I don't understand the last part of the question, but he's saying, can I do itikaf at home since the masajid are shut this Ramadan?
There are ibadat, we cannot do them except in the places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named him. Yani, for example, Umrah. Now, no one is allowed to go for Umrah. Can we do Umrah in our house? No, طبعًا. We cannot. There's only one place for Umrah. It's only Mecca. Yani, let's assume now in the UK they allow masajid open. And Saudi government is not allowing anybody to come into Saudi from outside Saudi, and they are not allowing Umrah performance due to the coronavirus. Now, can people perform Umrah in the masajid in England? No, طبعًا, because it needs a Kaaba, and there is only one Kaaba on this earth, that is in Mecca. So you cannot perform it except in Mecca. Now, Allah Ta'ala said in Surah Al-Baqarah, in the sequence of the ayat of Siyam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تُبَاشِرُهُنَّ وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ. And do not have relations with them, with your wives, as long as you are staying for worship in the masajid, in the mosque. So Allah Ta'ala named where the ibadah of i'tikaf to be done. That is the only place where to be done, in the masjid. So if we are not allowed to go to the masjid, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all kind. As in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا سَافَرَ الْمُسْلِمُ أَوْ مَرِضَ كتب الله له أجره أجر يعني العبادة التي يعملها كما كان صحيحا. He said, when the Muslim gets sick or travel or trouble, then Allah Ta'ala will give him the reward of the worship that he could not conduct because of his illness or traveling, as when he used to do it when he was yani healthy and residing. So in this situation, those who used to do i'tikaf, it's not wallahi, oh, this year because he's finding it yani no way to do i'tikaf in the masjid, one says, okay, this year I want to do i'tikaf, so Allah Ta'ala give me the reward of it. If you are serious and honest, and Allah knows best, knows what is in the heart, then yani we ask Allah Ta'ala to give you the reward. And Allah will give you the reward if Allah Ta'ala knows your honesty and willing to perform i'tikaf. But if you are just saying it to to get the reward and that's it, then you are not going to get the reward. No. But if you are somebody who every year, mashallah, perform i'tikaf, and this year you are unable because of this pandemic and the suspension of the masajid, then Allah will give you the reward of it. But i'tikaf cannot be in the house. Cannot be in the house. Now, wallahu a'lam.
أحسن الله إليكم شيخنا. السائل يقول: ما حكم ضرب الأولاد لتعليمه
وتفضيله؟
On hitting children. This is in regard to the child studying Arabic or other Islamic studies to correct their mistakes.
النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما يقول أنس بن مالك: خدمت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم 10 سنين. فوالله ما كهرني ولا نهارني ولا قال لشيء فعلته لما فعلته ولا لشيء لما فعله لم تفعله. فضلا عن أن يضرب. وأنس كان عمره 10 سنين. So Anas ibn Malik is saying that he said, I served Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم 10 years. And he began when he was only 10 years old. And he very young lad, very young child. He was 10 years old. And he said, I served Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam 10 years. In all these 10 years, and until Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam passed away, in all these 10 years, he said, by Allah, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam never yelled at me, never disciplined me, and never said to me for a thing that I did, why you did it? Or for a thing that I didn't do, why you didn't do it? Rather to be beating. And the other thing that the ulama say that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to hang, ويقول العلماء أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يعلق الصوت أو العصا على الجدار من باب من باب الإخافة فقط ليعلموا أنه ربما يكون هناك عقاب. So and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to hang the stick on the wall, just to show them that there might be a time when your disciplining going to be beating. لكن لو ما استعملها قط. He never ever beaten anybody. كما تقول أمنا عائشة صلى الله عليه وسلم ما ضرب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بيده شيئا قط إلا أن يكون قتالا في سبيل الله. Aisha رضي الله عنها said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم never hit anything with his hand except if it is something في سبيل الله, like in the jihad. ما غير ذلك ما كان يضرب. والتعليم بالرفق خير من التعليم بالضرب. انظر إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كيف ينصح عائشة. And teaching with kindness and tolerance and gentleness, better than and more fruitful than teaching with beating. Look to what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم done with Aisha. لما مر يهودي وقال السلام عليك يا محمد, والسلام في لغة اليهود الموت. والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تفطن له فقال وعليك مثل ما قلت. So when a Yahud man passed by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and Aisha was with him, and the Yahud man said Assalamu alayka ya Muhammad, trying to convince him that he is saying Assalam. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم knew that in Hebrew language that Assam means death. So he said to him, for you as you said as you said for me. لكن عائشة يعني غضبت, but Aisha became angry. فقالت السلام عليك واللعنة. She said, death on you and the curse of Allah. فقال لها النبي الآن ما ضربت عائشة. عائشة did not beat. فقال لها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يا عائشة ما كان الرفق, إن الله رفيق يحب الرفق في الأمر كله, ما كان الرفق في شيء إلا زانه وما نزع من شيء إلا شانه, وإن الله يعطي على الرفق ما يعطي على العنف. He صلى الله عليه وسلم said to her, oh Aisha, يعني tolerance and gentleness is never found in something except that it beautifies it, and never it is extracted from something except that it leaves it ugly. And he صلى الله عليه وسلم said to her, encouraging her, that Allah is يعني all tolerant, and he gives more reward for tolerance than harshness. فكونك معلم حببهم, لأن الضرب قد يكرههم في التعليم, قد يكرههم في التعليم. نعم قد يصار للضرب إذا يعني ارتكبت أخطاء ليست تعليمية, مفروض الأخطاء التعليمية تقابل بالتصحيح والتعليم, لكن مخالفات نعم يعاقب عليها, لكن العقاب يكون غير لا يعني الضرب يكون لا يترك أثر ولا يقطع الجلد ولا يكسر العظم. هذا هو التعليق يعني العقاب في المخالفات بالنسبة للصغار والنساء. نعم. What I wanted to say is that يعني disciplining with beating is not it's not a good way of يعني teaching and you know educating. نعم. But when the child is failing in learning, the best way is to look يعني why, maybe his capability of understanding this limit, maybe you were يعني explaining it يعني wrongly or shortly or like that. So try to يعني use other ways to make him understand it. Make him understand it. But if the child does wrong things, wrong actions, wrong sayings, not in the term of education, yes, you can discipline, but even if you want to يعني discipline with beating, it must not be beating in a way to leave mark, nor to cut skin, nor to break a bone. But just a slight like this to show him that he's done yani wrong. Same with the yani wives when they do wrong, like that. نعم. لكن الضرب الضرب بمعنى الضرب هذا لا يكون للتعليم بل قد ينفر من التعليم. But beating by meaning of beating that we all know and understand, that is not in education. That does not make people learn. That not, does not make people even love learning. نعم. لكن المعاملة الحسنة والكلمة الطيبة نعم هي التي تجعل الناس يقبلون على العلم. But the good dealing and relation and the good يعني wording, that is the thing that makes people understand and learn and يعني love learning. نعم. والله أعلم.
أحسن الله إليك شيخنا. السائل يقول if I need to pay for insurance on my warehouse and I must do it, otherwise I won't be able to use it, is this permissible?
Insurance in Islam is haram, is forbidden. Why? Because insurance is the same. It is under the categorization of maisir, which is the idea of gambling. Many people pay, and one or some people take. Now, that is haram. That is haram in Islam. And also from other side, called bay'ul gharar. And gharar means, and it's a transaction of gharar. Gharar means yani kind of unknown or deception. Now, but whoever is forced to pay, otherwise, yani for example, business, if you don't pay insurance, you cannot do business. Pay. Car, you cannot drive car if you don't pay insurance. No problem, pay. For example, some countries, they don't have free medication. You have to go through insurance company. No problem, pay. But in all these times of paying insurance, you cannot use more than, you cannot use, you cannot use more than the amount you paid. Let's give an example. Your annual insurance payment is £600, for example, of your car. And now you are driving your car and you made an accident. And now you have to fix the car of the other party or whatever you have. Or you have to, so now you cannot get the advantage for more than 600. If this time it is only 150, next time, even accumulated through the years, if you are with the same company, of course. But if you move from company to company, you cannot yani ask that company for what you paid for the other company last year. You know what I mean? So you can't use, because when Rasulullah Sallam was told, or he said, يَكُونُ فِيكُمْ أُمَرَاءَ, or a man said, Ya Rasulullah, what should we do when rulers come amongst us who ask us their rights, but they deny our rights? He Sallam said, give them their rights and ask Allah your right. And ask Allah for your right. So you only take the amount you paid, equal to the amount you paid. If your car fix goes more than, or cost more than the amount you paid, you don't take the extra. You're not allowed to do that. Now, wallahu a'lam.
Ahsan Allah, Shaykhana. This question is asking from YouTube. A question that says, Shaykh, if one is in marriage talks, is he or she allowed to ask the person they're pursuing if they committed particular sins, such as zina? Is it permissible to mention this sin to the one you are going to marry?
You mean she done that in the past?
I think from the question, what they're asking is, are you allowed to interview the, during the interview, are you allowed to ask such questions, such, have you committed,
you know, or to ask? No. You are not allowed to ask such questions. You are not allowed. You only can do your research about the spouse, whether the girl, yani family ask about the boy, or the boy ask about the girl, yani his way. But you cannot ask one another, have you ever met a girl, have you ever enjoyed a boy? That's not good, that's not correct. First of all, yani I don't know how come people ask these questions. Hurting the other person when you ask him this question. Yani somebody, for example, who is a practicer, and you come and ask him, have you committed zina? That's not correct. That's not correct at all. That's not correct. And you don't need to know about that. You don't need to know about that. You need to look for one who is now is a practicer, is educated about his or her deen, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. عليك بذات الدين تربت يداك. Go for the girl with the yani who's practicing. Otherwise, your hands only filled with soil, meaning you lost. And to the girl, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, إذا أتاكم من ترضون دينه وخلقه وزوجوا. When one when a man approaches your girl for marriage, and he is someone who is up on good manners and characters and practicing, then accept him. So these are the criteria yani needed to be taken in measurement for both spouses. I mean both yani parties of yani the marriage, the man and the boy and the girl. They need to ask about each other, but not ask each other. And when you ask about each other, don't go and ask people, did he commit zina? Did he? No, that's not correct. You ask about how is his practicing, how is his manner, how is his, characters, how is his etiquette. And that can give you the observation. And you need to, do istikhara, salatul istikhara, after you ask about this person, the man or the girl. Wallahu
a'lam. Ahsan wa Allah alaykum, Shaykhana. This question is asking from Zoom. My brother refuses to lead for jama'at prayer at home. Is he sinning by doing so? And can me and my mom do it separately instead?
He should be the one who asked you to pray with him, because the women are not, it's not obligatory upon women to pray in jama'ah. Yani Aisha, Hafsa, Sauda, Umm Salama, they were living next to each other, wall to wall. But they did not used to call one another and pray jama'ah. Sometimes, maybe if they are gathering, they pray jama'ah. But regularly, everyone prays by her own. But the man, jama'ah for the man is needed, is compulsory. So he needs to ask you to pray with him jama'ah so that he get the reward of jama'ah. Not that him refuses, that's wrong. But of course, if he refuses and you want to pray jama'ah, that's okay. But for women, some ulama say that it must not be constant. Yani, all the days, all the fruit, you pray jama'ah. Because this was never the thing that the wives of Rasulullah Sallam used to be upon, nor any woman of the Sahaba. Yes, sometimes they do it, or maybe in Ramadan for Salatul Layl, they used to pray jama'ah. That's a different thing. But in the obligatory prayers, they normally pray individually. In such circumstances now, when the man is not allowed to leave the house and go to the masjid, then it's good that the female in the house pray with him so that he can get the reward of jama'ah. Wallahu a'lam.
Ahsan Allah alaykum, Shaykhana. A sister here asked, Assalamu alaykum. I have a river friend who has decided she wanted to leave the religion because of doubts that she has received from her family. How can I go about advising her?
Wallahi, this cannot be a general answer, because we need to know the case and what these doubts and why. You need to remove the doubts, because she has doubts now. You need to remove the doubts from her from her brain. You need to remove the doubts. That's all what you need to do. And if you are not qualified and knowledge-wise, then you need to connect her to someone with knowledge so that they can remove these doubts. And at the same time, you can ask, you can make dua for her. Ask Allah Ta'ala to make her stay on the religion.